This is our fourth video for Chapter 4 on Igneous Rocks. We're going to talk about where magma originates. One way magma originates is by decompression melting. As convection occurs in the mantle along divergent plate boundaries, as that mantle rock comes closer to the surface, the pressure is decreased, allowing the bonds to break and melting to occur. Here's an image showing decompression melting where we have our solid peridotite down in the mantle, convection occurring, and as a result, pressure's lowering and that rock melting. That rock is now a basalt in composition and may come up to the ocean crust and ooze out onto the crust, forming new ocean crust. The addition of a flux such as water will lower the melting point of the peridotite in the mantle. This is called flux melting, and this primarily occurs at subduction zones. Here's ocean crust subducting beneath the continental crust, as it always does. Continents never subduct, if you remember, always ocean crust because it is more dense. Once you get down to a certain depth where temperatures are high enough, the water that is present in the minerals in the rocks will dehydrate and introduce that water into the mantle peridotite. That lowers its melting point and magma forms and works its way up through the crust. An increase in temperature can also create a magma from a solid rock. As an example, as when a peridotite begins to melt, it becomes or evolves into a basalt. That basalt will pond or pool at the base of the lower crust and create enough heat sometimes to cause that crustal rock to melt. Let's take a look at that. Here is the pooling or ponding basalt providing heat into the continental crust, which may allow that rock to melt then. Let's talk about magma evolution. A single volcano can extrude a variety of compositions of material. When we look at Bowen's reaction series, this shows that silicate minerals crystallize out in a systematic fashion depending upon their melting points. The first to crystallize is olivine. It is considered a high temperature mineral. Once we have removed olivine, which is an iron and or magnesium silicate mineral, the remaining liquid that is left behind has a new composition. In other words, it has evolved. Let's take a closer look at Bowen's reaction series. What I want you to notice is the temperature starts at around 1200 Celsius, going down to 750 degrees Celsius. Here are our magma compositions, ultramafic, mafic, intermediate, and felsic. And these are the silicate minerals and the order in which they crystallize. There are two series shown here, the discontinuous series and the continuous series. With the discontinuous series, we see that olivine crystallizes first, then pyroxene, amphibole, biotite, so these are our ferromagnesium minerals. Then the last to crystallize are our non-ferromagnesium minerals, with quartz being last. This continuous series is a series of plagioclase feldspars. This series has a calcium-rich end member and a sodium-rich end member. The calcium-rich end member is a higher temperature plagioclase feldspar compared to the sodium-rich end member. Continuing on with how magmas evolve, let's start with magmatic differentiation. This is a process where the formation of one or more secondary magmas occurs from a single parent. This can occur by crystal settling. The earliest form minerals, what we call our high-temperature minerals, are heavier or more dense and will settle to the bottom of the magma chamber. When the remaining magma solidifies, the mineralogy is going to be different from the parent because those minerals were removed from it. Let's go through the steps in crystal settling. Here we have a basaltic magma body. It's erupting at the Earth's surface in a lava flow. With continued cooling of this magma, olivine, pyroxene, and calcium-rich plagioclase feldspar will crystallize and settle to the bottom of the chamber. The remaining magma will then be a different composition and also more silica-rich and closer to the felsic end of the compositional range than the parent magma. Assimilation is another process where we can get a new composition of magma. That simply is a process when magma is moving through the earth, it can drag in and incorporate solid rock. And these xenoliths can then change the composition of that magma. Magma mixing occurs when you have two different magmas joining together into one. In this first image, the magma is coming up through the Earth's brittle upper crust and incorporating, dislodging and incorporating the surrounding, what we call host rock. Melting of this host rock will now change the overall composition of this magma body. We have evolved it. This image is showing magma mixing. We have magma body A, magma body B. They're joining together, and as a result, we have a new composition for magma. Incomplete melting of rocks is called partial melting, and this is, in fact, what produces most of our magmas. During partial melting, the melted portion is enriched in ions from minerals with low melting temperatures. For example, partial melting of an ultramafic rock will yield mafic magmas. Partial melting of mafic yields intermediate, and intermediate will yield felsic magmas. This is our rock made up of olivine, quartz, plagge, potassium feldspar, pyroxene, and amphibole. We're going to partially melt this. So the low temperature minerals will melt first. Quartz, sodium-rich plagioclase, and potassium feldspar. This produces a melt having an intermediate or felsic composition. What is left behind, the unmelted residue, will be left with the amphibole, pyroxene, and olivine. So it will have a mafic composition. Here's a diagram starting with our peridotite making up the magma, the mantle, I should say. We partially melt the peridotite, which creates a basaltic magma, which is less dense than the peridotite, so it rises up to the bottom of the continental crust where it ponds. Partial melting of the continental crust will generate magma then with a granitic composition. So we're starting with an ultramafic and ending up with a felsic composition. Most magma solidifies within the earth, never making it to the earth's surface. We call these magma bodies plutons. They are intrusive igneous bodies. And we classify our plutons based on their shape and orientation with respect to the surrounding rock. A tabular pluton means table-like. If the tabular pluton cuts across existing rock layers, we call it discordant. If it is parallel with the sedimentary rock layers, it is concordant. We can also have a massive pluton that's simply a blob shape. This diagram shows a variety of plutons. We have a laccolith, dikes, sills. When smaller magma chambers called stocks solidify into a large magma body, that is a batholith. An example of a tabular intrusive igneous body is a dike. It is tabular and discordant. A sill, on the other hand, is a tabular concordant pluton. Here is an image of a sill going parallel with the existing strata or rock layers. Here's a picture of a dike. It's cutting through the existing rock layers. Columnar jointing can form when magma cools and it's cooling from the outside, and shrinkage cracks form into these six-sided columns. Batholiths are the largest plutons, over 100 plus square kilometers. Smaller bodies are termed stocks. Batholiths are the cores of mountain chains. Here we're looking at the Coast Range batholiths, the Idaho, the Sierra Nevada, and Southern California batholiths. A laccolith is a variation of a sill where lava has been injected between the sedimentary rock layers, causing the rock layers to arch upward in a mushroom shape. You can call it an overinflated sill. Here's a geologist sketch of a laccolith. This is Mount Ellen in the Henry Mountains of Utah. Some dikes and sills are present as well. Here's an actual live image. And that concludes Chapter 4. We will continue Chapter 5 with discussing different types of volcanoes and volcanic activity and what makes a volcano erupt violently versus quietly.